Well, hallelujah. Glory. Hopefully, we're going to close out the book of Judges today. We have three chapters left in the book of Judges, and we're going to try to close out that whole book if we can. And if I had to put a title on the message this morning, it would be Bad Decisions Lead to Tragedy. Bad decisions lead to tragedy. Bad decisions being not seeking God's will beforehand. And then we start out in Judges chapter 19. So if you have a Bible and you want to turn to Judges 19 and follow along, you can. It says, in those days Israel didn't have a king. Now this is repeated again in this whole story. In fact, it ends. Judges ends. In those days Israelites did not have a king. And I'm reminded that in Proverbs it says that without a prophetic vision or without leadership, the people run wild. But blessed are those who follow God's teachings. In these days, where judges are, there was no king. Now there was some leaders, and they were the Levites. They were the people that were appointed to be the spiritual leaders in the nation of Israel. They were to be the priests, and they were to take care of the tabernacle and the Ark of the Covenant and so forth. So it says a Levite who lived in a remote area, he's not named, we don't have a name for this Levite, he lived in the remote area of the mountains of Ephraim, took a woman from Bethlehem in Judah to be his concubine. And you go, okay, now, first of all, we should probably talk about that. What is a concubine? A concubine was a woman that acted as wife to a man, and he took care of her as a wife. It's the difference between a wife and a concubine in the Bible is that in order for a man to be set free from a wife, he had to go through the whole process, a legal process, ritualistic process of divorce. Whereas with a concubine, if he wanted to be free from her, all he had to do is open the door and shove her out. Other than that, they were the same. Their children were treated the same. The children had the same benefits, no matter whether it was a wife or a concubine. The difference being that a concubine was not formally considered a wife. Now she could be a Hebrew girl who was purchased from her father because the father. You know, in those days, if you were needy, you had need of finances, you could put your children into servitude. You could put yourself into servitude. But in many cases, these girls would be sold as wives or as concubines to men who could pay the father for them. You could be a Gentile captive of war. A Gentile who was captive, who was made captive in a time of war, could become a concubine. If the man loved her and wanted to bring her into his home and take care of her, she could be a concubine. The other is a slave that was bought could become a concubine. Or the last was a Canaanite woman. Now, the thing is this. The first two, the Hebrew girl and the Gentile captive, they were covered by the laws of Israel, and the man was responsible for taking care of her. And there was, you know, they were treated as family. They were treated as family, and they had all the privileges of being in the family. The foreigner who was a slave was not covered the same way as the other two. And the last one, the Canaanite woman, that was actually forbidden. So anyhow, this Levite had a concubine from Bethlehem, so she was a Jewish girl. And she had been with him for 4 months. She had been unfaithful to him, I'm sorry. And she left him. And she went back to her father's house. And 4 months later, her husband went back to persuade her to come home. And this starts out, you know, I said if I had to make a title here, I'd say it was Bad Decisions Lead to Tragedy. The first bad decision we have here is this concubines. She made the decision that she did not want to be the wife or the concubine of this Levite. And in doing so, she ended up back at her father's house. And this Levite went to her father's house to get her. Now the father was happy to see the Levite because in his eyes, his daughter belonged to this man, and it was like it was her husband. He was the father-in-law of this Levite, and so it was bringing the family back together. He was seeing that the Levite wanted to rejoin himself to this girl, even though she'd been unfaithful to him. And so while they were there, they fellowshiped together for 3 days. And on verse 5 it says, on the fourth day they got up early in the morning to leave, but the father-in-law said, you know, no, stick around, let's have some meal together. And so here is the second bad decision. The first bad decision was the girl who was going to leave her husband. The second bad decision was to stay there in her house. And so in verse 6 it says they sat down, they ate and drank together. And when the Levite wanted to leave, the father-in-law urged him to stay, and so he stayed. The next bad decision. Seems like, well, these are not necessarily bad decisions, it's just decisions, right? Listen, any decision we make that we do not ask God about first, has the possibility of being a bad decision, and every bad decision has the possibility of turning out to be a tragedy in our lives. Thing is, we need to be searching God. We need to be going to God and asking Him, Lord, what do you want me to do in this particular case? Now, I don't know whether the Levite asked God if it was okay, if this was the right girl for him, and if he should have her as a concubine. It doesn't go back that far. I do know that the girl made a bad decision. Now, the Levite went to get her, which is probably not a bad decision, but the bad decision started following as he kept on being trapped into staying there with her and her father-in-law. And so they every day for the fourth day, the fifth day, and every time the Levite would go to leave with his concubine, the father-in-law would ask him to stay. On the fifth day, the father-in-law, they got up to leave, and the father-in-law said, no, have some meal with us first. Don't leave empty, you know, with an empty stomach. We want you to, you know, feel be full and have energy to go when you leave. And it came towards the end of the day, and just like the days before, the father-in-law tried to get the Levite to spend the night again in the father-in-law's house. Now, apparently the Levite was starting to understand that daddy's not going to let us go. You know, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. Daddy's not going to let us go. But the Levite refused, verse 10, he refused to spend another night. And so he left and traveled as far as what is now called Jerusalem. It was Jebus. And he had with him two donkeys. And by the time they were near Jerusalem, it was very late in the day. And the servant of the Levite said, well, let's just spend the night here. Now, at this particular time, this town did not belong to the Israelites. It still had Canaanites living there. And the Levite said, no, we're not going to spend the night in a Gentile town. We're going to go to a Hebrew town. And so they pressed on. And when they went on to Gibeah. Now, Gibeah was in that area by the Ephraim. And he said, we're going to spend the night here. It was actually in the area of Benjamin, which is kind of between Judah and Ephraim. And we'll go there and we'll spend the night. So he goes to that town. And in Gibeah, or Ramah, they entered in and they sat down in the city square. Now, we saw this kind of happen once before. Remember way back when God had brought a judgment against Sodom and Gomorrah, and the angels came down and they sat in the square until Lot invited them into their house. And this is a very similar story, but now this is happening years later. Remember, Sodom and Gomorrah happened during the time of Abraham. Now, all of Israel has been made into a nation since then. And we see in this town of Benjamin a similar scenario. That evening, an old man came into the city from his work in the fields, and he was from the mountain region of Ephraim, but he lived in Gibeah. And the other people who lived there were from the tribe of Benjamin. And he saw the traveler in the city square. He says, where are you coming from? And the Levite replied, well, we're on our way from Bethlehem in Judah up into Ephraim. Now, remember last week we said that the Ark of the Covenant was being held in Ephraim at Shiloh. Now, it didn't stay there permanently because they would move it as they needed. If they were going to go to war, sometimes they would take the Ark and the priest would take that Ark and go to the place where there was a war. And there they would offer sacrifices to God, seek his will, and then before they went on to war. But at this time, the ark was in Shiloh, which is up north in Ephraim. He says, we're going up to Ephraim. And so this man said, well, don't stay here in the square. Come on into my house, and I'll make sure that your animals are fed, and we'll take care of you. So in verse 21, he took the Levite into his house, fed his donkeys, and after they had washed and ate and drank, while they were enjoying themselves, some of the worthless men, I want you to see that, they were worthless men from the city, surrounded the house and pounded on the door, and they told the old man, the owner of the house, bring out the man who came to your house so that we can have sex with him. Remember I said, it's just like a repeat of Sodom and Gomorrah, but now it's in the nation of Israel. Remember as we were talking about this over, as we're going through the book of Judges, we were seeing how the people, as they refused to push the enemy out, and they started to receive the practices and the religions that the enemies, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Hivites, the Perizzites, and all the rest of the ites out there were doing, they started sinking deeper and deeper and deeper into sin. And so it says, these men, the worthless men of this town, said, banged on the door and said, send those men out that came to visit with you because we want to have a homosexual relationship with them. Same as it was in Sodom and Gomorrah. The owner went out to them and told them, no, please don't do this evil. This man is a guest in my home. Don't do such a godless thing. If there's any question in your mind whether or not God will sanction that kind of a relationship, the Bible over and over and over again says no. You can get mad at me if you like. It doesn't matter because I didn't say that. God did. His Word did. And we're just standing on the Word of God. See, we're here to teach the Word of God, not to teach my ideas, your ideas, or anyone else's. So the man said, let me bring out my virgin daughter and this man's concubine, and you can do whatever you like with them. See, we have this, again, in our Western Hemisphere, in our American way of thinking, this becomes just as bad a thing in our minds as what the men were wanting to do. In that Eastern living, the Eastern society that they lived in, it was much less a sin for these men to take these girls out and rape them and do whatever they wanted to with them than it was for them to have this relationship with the men. Again, this lets us know where God is. And that's the one thing that we all need to know. We need to know where is God standing on these kind of issues. Not where I stand, not where you stand, not where Uncle Joe stands or Aunt Mary. What does God have to say about these things? So he says, just don't do this godless thing. We'll send the girls out and you can have them and do whatever you like with them. But the men refused to listen. So the Levite grabbed a hold of his concubine, opened the door and shoved her out. And so it says they abused her. They abused her. They had abused her all night until morning. And then they let her go. And as the day came up, the woman went back to the house of this man where her husband was staying. She fell at the door and she died right there on the doorpost because they had mistreated her so abusively. In verse 27, it says this Levite got up, he opened the door, he saw his wife, or there's his concubine, was lying on the door of the house, and he told her that to get up, and she couldn't, she didn't, because she had been murdered, and so he put her on his donkey and left for home. When he arrived at home, now this is, again, see, this is one of the most gory stories in the Bible, and I'm trying to make it as light as I can without making it too terrible. He took his concubine, he cut her limb from limb into 12 pieces. Then he sent the pieces throughout the territories of Israel. And everyone who saw it said, never has such a thing happened or been seen from the time that Israel came out of Egypt till today. Think about it. Form a plan, it said. They said, form a plan and speak out. Another decision. They didn't say, well, let's go to God and say, God, what do we do here? They just said, form a plan and speak out about it. So here we are going into chapter 20, and the people have made another bad decision. They're going to form a plan without seeking God. It says, all the people of Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, from Gilead to Mizpah, the congregation stood united in the presence of the Lord. The leaders of all Israel tribes took their places in the congregations of God's people. There was about 400,000 foot soldiers with swords. The people of Benjamin heard that Israel had come to Mizpah. And the people of Israel said, tell us how such an evil thing could happen. They're asking Benjaminites, how could this happen? The Levite then told the whole story. The Levite told what had gone on. And he says, and they raped my concubine until she died. So I took the concubine, cut her into pieces, and sent all the pieces out to you. And I did this because the citizens of Gibeah did this perverted and godless thing in Israel. Listen, I've often said, I don't get surprised when sinners sin. It doesn't surprise me at the evil that sinners do. Because sinners are under the influence of their own sinful nature and the influence of Satan, and are going to do those kind of things that the sinful nature and Satan dictate. And so that's what sinners do. But Christians, on the other hand, should be doing what Christians do, and Christians are always supposed to seek the Lord first, seek the kingdom of God first and all of His righteousness, and let God dictate to them how to deal with problems. Now, these people gathered there where the ark was, but it doesn't say they ever went to God and asked Him, what should we do? They went there with their own idea about how they were going to deal with this problem. And so, they said in verse 7 of chapter 20, all of you people of Israel, tell me what you think. Give me your advice right now. And all the people stood united, saying, none of us will go to this tent or return to his house. This is what we'll do to Gibeah. They made a decision, again, without seeking the Lord. Another bad decision. Now, we have the bad decision of the concubine. We have the decision of the Levite not to stay in a city that was Gentile, but go to Gibeah. Then we have the decision that the people of Gibeah had about this Levite, and then the decision to send the concubine out, and then a decision made to cut her up in little pieces and send it out all over the country. And now again, a decision that we're going to handle this. We're not going to go home until we've taken care of us. And this is what we'll do to Gibeah. We'll decide by lot who should attack, and then we'll take it. And they're taking 10% of all the people, 10% of every group of people that was there, and they're going to send them out. And it says, they're going to go into the territory of Benjamin, and they can punish the citizens of Gibeah for the godless thing which they did in Israel. This was not necessarily a bad decision. We're going to punish those evil people. We need to punish the evil people. And when people do evil things, they need to be held accountable for it, and they need to be punished. But the fact that they made the decision without asking God how they should deal with this problem makes it a questionable decision. Sometimes the decisions that you make may seem right. In fact, they might be right according to Scripture. But if you don't ask God whether or not you should make that decision, you can possibly be making a decision based upon your emotions and your fallible understanding, and not based upon the leading of the Holy Spirit. And we've talked about this in the past too, that God's word is true. God's word is true, and every man is a liar. God is true in all things. Everything the Bible says to us is absolutely true. The problem we have is that our understanding is not complete when it comes to the Bible. We understand things differently maybe than what it was meant to say. That means that we haven't studied, we haven't been listening to the Holy Spirit, we haven't been allowing God to to open up our understanding and teach us the truth of what he's doing here. So you can make a decision based upon Scripture, and it can still be wrong if you have not sought the Lord and say, God, what do I do here? Because I'll be honest with you, we can find Scripture to back up all kinds of causes. And the thing is this, when we seek the Lord with all of our heart, when we seek the Lord with all of our heart, when we entrust in Him, and we let Him be the ruler of our lives, He will direct us in the proper way. He'll direct us in the proper way. It says, you know, we have this command of Jesus, love your enemies. Well, what does that mean? See, and as we took that command of Jesus, it says, love your enemies, and we went too far with it, if we did it improperly, what we would end up doing is destroying ourselves and allowing our enemies just to run roughshod over us and destroy us and our nations and all the things that we love, and even destroy the church. So there is a right way of understanding things and a wrong way of understanding things, even if we try to make our decisions based upon what we think we know about the Scripture. The Scripture is true. Sometimes our understanding is flawed. We need to have that ability to make that decision. Am I understanding this completely? And one of the things that we've talked about in the past is, if we think that we know what the Word of God says, then we look at the person who said it, or if it's something that God said through a prophet, we look at what that prophet is saying, and then we see how in the natural it is lived out. So if I read something that Paul says, for instance, and I develop, Paul says this one thing, and I'm not going to get involved in too many things here because I'll never get through with the book of Judges. If Paul says something, then I need to look at Paul's life and see, was this a practice of Paul's? Or if it was a practice of Paul's, then I can understand what he said. If I see things in Paul's life that say, no, he wasn't practicing what I think he said over here, then the problem there is not in what Paul said, it is how I understood what he said. And I need to go back, and I need to ask God to open up my understanding and teach me so that I can understand better what I thought I understood in the first place, because what I thought I understood, I don't see in action in the person who said it. And it's a good way to study the Word of God. Not just read the Bible, not just take what is said as in our own understanding, but to take that what is said, and that's why God says, study to show yourself approved unto God, workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. We need to take what we think it says, look at the person who said it. Is he living or she living out what we thought they said here? And if not, well, then I need to go back and say, okay, when they said this, what exactly were they saying? Maybe I misunderstood. Because if I misunderstand, it will lead me wrongly. So these people said, we're going to go and punish the people, the citizens of Gibeah, because these citizens of Gibeah need to be punished because their lifestyle is not the lifestyle of people who are the children of God. They're not the lifestyle of Israelites, the people of God. They're doing things that God has told us absolutely do not do. And so they can't be part of this community that we call Israel. In fact, if we go back into Deuteronomy and we read in Numbers and we read about these things, it says people who are found doing these things should be put out. So all the men of Israel assembled, and they stood united against Gibeah. And they sent men throughout the tribes of Benjamin. And they said, how could such a thing happen? Now, hand over the worthless men of Gibeah, which was reasonable. You hand over the culprits, we'll take care of them. But another, because we're going to put them to death and rid ourselves of this kind of evil in Israel. But another bad decision. The men of Benjamin refused to listen. And instead of handing over the wicked men, they gathered themselves together that day and made an army and decided to fight. See, if they had just if they had just gone back and said, well, this is what God's law says about people who do these kind of things, and so we're going to turn them over for the punishment that God's law requires, it would have been a good decision. But their decision was based upon sentiment. And one of the things that we need to guard ourselves against here in this land, as well as any land, is making decisions based upon sentiment. Because when we start making decisions based upon sentiment, what we are going to do is we're going to push God's rules, God's will aside, and say, whatever feels good to me, whatever seems good to me, that's what we're going to do. And it really doesn't matter what God said. I think that I know better than God. When we make our rules based upon sentiment, what we are doing is elevating ourselves above God when we're making our rules and saying, God, you really don't understand the situation. You really don't know what you're talking about. And we're in a situation now that we can see it better than you can, God, and so we're going to make our own decisions here. That was exactly the temptation that took place in the Garden of Eden when this snake went to Eve and he says, look, if you eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, guess what's going to happen? You're going to become like God and you'll know right and wrong. You'll know good and evil yourself. You can make up your own mind about what is good. See, it isn't the fact that tree had anything that was bad in it. It was the fact that the attitude toward what God had said and the attitude toward what would happen if they disobeyed God was going to destroy humanity. The attitude being, I won't need God, I can make up my own mind. And some of you out there, some of you here, have been in that place where you say, I know what God said and I don't really need what God said. I'm going to make up my own mind. I'm going to do what I want to do because that's what I want to do. I think it's right to do it this way. I know what the Bible says, but I think it's right to do it this way. When we get that but word in there, all of a sudden we start to veer off of the path of truth, veer off the path of blessing, veer off of the path of eternal life, and get involved in the worldliness and sinfulness that God says He will not allow in His presence. So these people in Gibeah had the opportunity to say, well, God's word says this is what we should do. The Israelites are here to carry out that word of God. We'll do that. We'll take these evil men and we'll give them over to the Israelites for their punishment. But instead they said, no, we're going to stand up and fight on their behalf. Right now, and this is kind of a current event, and for those of you who might be listening to this later on down the road. Right now we're going through an issue in Israel where the Palestinians living in that territory, which at one time was the Philistines areas, Palestine, began to send rockets into Israel. And in return, Israel has invaded Palestine and has vowed to get rid of the Hamas, which are the group that was there doing that. And I see a lot of people here in our own country who are saying Israel has no right to do this. And I want to remind you that as we look into the Bible, and here again, you have to know what the Bible says. And you have to understand that God is God, and God can do what God wants to do, and because He's God and we're not. That if we look at the Bible, all of that land that goes from the Euphrates River, and you can look at any map you want, all the way over to the Mediterranean Sea, was given by God to Isaac, Abraham's son, and to the tribes of Israel. And so anyone living in that whole territory that is not Israel is living there by the grace of Israel. They're living there because Israel has not demanded to have their own territory back. And you go, well, but those people have been living there for hundreds of years. That's okay. God had determined thousands of years ago that it belonged to Israel, and it belongs to Israel. Nobody changed God's mind. God didn't change His mind. God didn't make a statement saying, okay, well, we're going to fix this. We'll let this other territory that used to belong to Israel belong to somebody else. So the Palestinians were living in Israel by Israel's consent. But then they chose to attack the one who gave consent for them to live there. And just like you would do if someone moved into your house and then decided that they were going to destroy your family, you're going to put them out. And that's exactly what's happening in Israel. Why? Because God said, this is the land of Israel. I've given this land to the Jews. God said so. And it is not up to how I feel about it. It's not up to whether or not I think Israel is right in everything that they do. It has nothing to do with it. It is the fact that God is right in everything He does, and it doesn't make any difference how I feel about that. He is right. And it doesn't make any difference in how you feel about it. He is right. So let us make sure that we put God first. Let His word be true and every man a liar. Because that's what the Word of God says. So let's keep it at that. That day, 26,000 men from Benjamin came to Gibeah, and they organized a war. And so the Israelites had 400,000. The men of Israel went to Bethel, and they asked God, okay, who's going to go first? They didn't ask God whether they should go, but now they're going to say, okay, when we go in, who's going to go first? The Lord answered, send Judah first. So the Israelites got up early in the morning. They went to Gibeah. The Israelites formed their battle line facing Gibeah. And that day, the men of Benjamin came out from Gibeah and they killed 22,000 Israelites. Now, remember, I titled this, Bad Decisions End in Tragedy. The Israelites hadn't done anything wrong. They were trying to do everything right, but the wrong thing they did was not to ask God how to go about doing this before they started. They were in the middle of doing their own thing before they stopped and said, okay, God, tell us how to do what we're going to do. We're going to do this, Lord. Now you just tell us how to do it. And so the first day they went out there, 22,000 Israelites are killed by the men of Benjamin. It ends in tragedy. So the Israelites got reinforcements. And they went out, they said to the Lord, now should we go ahead and continue this? God said, go ahead. On the second day, they went out to Gibeah. This time, 18,000 Israelites are killed. So right now, we have 40,000 people killed because a concubine made the decision to be unfaithful to her husband. The husband made the decision not to stop in Jerusalem, instead to go into the area of Benjamin. The people in Gibeah decided that they were going to disobey the law of God and they were going to have a homosexual relationship with this man and his servant. The Levite then made the decision that he was going to cut this woman up into pieces and send them throughout all of Israel. And Israelites made the decision that they were going to go against Gibeah and they were going to wipe it out. And they did all of that without ever asking God what He wanted. Bad decisions, one after another, one bad decision led to the next bad decision, which led to the next bad decision, and so forth. And now we have 40,000 dead men laying on the ground. It doesn't say that Levite was one of them. So then, all of the men of Israel went and took their troops to Bethel. And they called for the Ark of the Covenant to be brought there. And they cried in the presence of the Lord, and they fasted until evening. And then they sacrificed burnt offerings and fellowship offerings to the Lord. This is what they should have done at the very beginning. They should have been seeking the Lord. Seek the Lord with all of your heart. Seek Him. Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness. Ask of God. In all of your ways, acknowledge Him. See, they should have been doing this at the very beginning. Some of you out there are doing exactly what these people did. You have made up your mind. You're going to do something, regardless of what God has said. You said, I want this, I'm going to do it, I don't care, I'm willing to suffer the consequences. Let me tell you something. I have met so many people who, in their young years, decided to get married to someone that they knew they shouldn't get married to because that person was not a Christian. Only to find out that their life and their family life was always filled with controversy and tragedy and all the problems that could possibly happen, only to find out that in the end they would have been better off single for the rest of their lives than they would have been marrying the person they did. And not only that, but the children that they had also were under that same kind of influence. And they, in turn, were suffering because of a decision that was made. And sometimes many of them refused to serve the Lord because they couldn't see that God was in their family. And whether a mother or a father was the one who was propagating the fact that we were Christians and we're gonna do what the Lord wants, didn't make any difference because they couldn't see that working in their lives because these people were being contradictory to the Word of God. And it just goes on and on and on and on. Bad decisions result in tragedy, whether it's a personal tragedy or it's a historic or a national tragedy. Bad decisions will result in tragedy. And the only way that you can make a good decision is to seek the Lord first. Sacrifice, fast, seek the Lord fast, and then sacrifice. We don't sacrifice burnt offerings anymore, but you can sacrifice your ideas. You can sacrifice your pride. You can sacrifice the things that you have desired and say, put them before the Lord and say, listen, Lord, you can take this from me. I don't care. I'm going to put it before you. Whatever you want to do with this, if it's not right, get it out of my life. I just want to serve you. You can do that. But if we refuse to seek the Lord, then we're opening ourselves up to making bad decisions, which will result in more bad decisions, which will result in tragedy eventually. It says, in those days, the Ark of the Covenant came to Bethel. And Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, the grandson of Aaron, served in front of it. So the people of Israel asked God. First time there was ever a good move here. Should we continue to wage the war against the relatives in Benjamin? And the Lord said, go, and tomorrow I will turn them over to you. So the next day, the third day, the men of Israel went out to fight the Benjamites, Benjamin, and they formed their battle facing Gibeah like they did before. And so the men of Gibeah came out, and they started to inflict casualties just like they did before, and they killed about 30 men from Israel in the open country. But God had directed them this time. God was directing Israel this time. And so in doing so, he told them what they should do. And they had set up encampments on the other side of Gibeah. So when the soldiers of Gibeah of Benjamin came out to fight against the Israelites, the ones that were on the other side came in and they overtook the city and they destroyed the city. They set it on fire. And so While the soldiers from Benjamin were fighting the Israelites out front, thinking, okay, we're just going to destroy them like we did the previous 2 days, their city in Gibeah was being destroyed and everybody in it was being destroyed. And it says, 10,000 of Israel's best men attacked Gibeah, and they overtook it, and they defeated them. And 25,100 men of Benjamin died. So now we have 65,130 men in 3 days lying dead on the ground. 65,130. America fought in Vietnam for 10 years and had 50,000 casualties. These people fought for 3 days and had 65,130 killed. Because somebody was making bad decisions. Now, we may not have that kind of a devastation in the bad decisions that we make. But mark my words, when we start making bad decisions without asking God, what should I do here? What do you want me to do? How should I handle this issue? How should I raise my kids? Should I make them go to church? Should I put them in this certain school? Should I teach them these things? Should I encourage them to live this way? When we have this relationship with the husbands and wives and we don't go to the Lord and say, how should I respond to this? How should I deal with this? When we're in our own jobs, in our own lives, and we're looking at our futures, and we go, God, what do you want me to do? How do you want me to deal with this? How do you want me to handle this? Where do you want me to go here, Lord? What direction should I go? What walk should I walk here? When we don't go to God and ask Him first, we are going to make decisions that may turn out to be tragic in our lives. That's what these people were of Israel and Gibeah were doing. And the tragedy ended up for them, 65,130 dead men laying on the ground. For you, it might just be a destroyed marriage, a destroyed family, or a destroyed career. It might just mean that you have gotten so accustomed to walking the worldly life that you destroy your own soul because you walk away from God. Jesus said, what would a man give for his own soul? What would happen if you gained the entire world but lost your soul? Bad decisions. Bad decisions can put us there. So when 25,000 Benjamites were killed, 600 of them escaped and ran into the woods. You know, thing is, it doesn't say out of that 600, 50 of them were the guys that were trying to, that started all of this, who tried to get the Levite out so that they could abuse him. It doesn't say that. They may or may not have been there. At this point, that isn't what really matters. But at this point, what matters is only 600 men of the entire tribe of Benjamin are still alive. So the Israelites destroyed in verse 48. All of the people and animals of the Benjamin cities. They went out after the 600 and they destroyed all of the cities of Benjamin and all of the people that lived in the cities. And so now more have died. They killed off the women, they killed off the children, they killed off the animals. They killed all the people and the cattle they found in every city, and they burned down every city they came to. And that ends chapter 20. Some of these two chapters are some of the most tragic chapters in the Bible. And we go on to chapter 21. And all of a sudden, the men of Israel, they had taken an oath saying, none of us are ever going to let any of our daughters marry anyone from Benjamin, because we don't want our daughters married into that kind of a society. And the people went to Bethel, and they sat there in the presence of God until evening, and they cried loudly, and they said, Lord, God of Israel, why has this happened amongst us? Why should one tribe be missing today in Israel? Now, wait a minute. That's kind of a stupid question. You know, first of all, they made another stupid decision here by saying, we're not going to let any of our daughters marry any of the men in Benjamin. Not all the men in Benjamin were guilty of these things. Then they come to verse 3 and it says, why should this happen? Well, it happened, my friends in Israel, because you made some stupid decisions. That's why it happened. You know, we sometimes do dumb things. We do things without asking God. We do things without worrying about or caring about what God has to say about it. We just do it because that's what we want to do. And when it turns out tragically, we go, oh, why is this happening to me? What's happening to you because you did something dumb? The next day, the people got up and they built an altar there and sacrificed burnt offerings and fellowship offerings. And the people asked, okay, is there anybody in Israel that has not taken the oath to not let their daughters marry the people in Benjamin? And they said, well, yeah, there is a group, because you know these people were feeling sorry, making again sentiment was ruling them. So they found that there was a group. No one from Jabesh-Gilead had come out with the rest of the Israelites. Now here's another, we're going to see another foolish decision. Nobody from Jabesh-Gilead had come out when they were going to war against Benjamin. And they had made an oath saying, well, if you aren't going to come out and help us, you must be against us, or we're going to kill you. I mean, you would think that, you know, 46,130 people. Was that right? 46? 65,000 dead would be enough. They said, no, these guys from Jabesh-Gilead, they didn't come out and help us. So they sent 12,000 soldiers, and they said, we want you to go kill all of the people in Jabesh-Gilead, including the women and the children. The only ones we want you to save are the young women who are still virgins. And then the stupid thing was, claim everyone there, every woman who has gone to bed with a man, claim that one for the Lord. And destroy them, kill them. where in the world are they coming up with these ideas, making these kind of decisions? So they go out and they go to Jabesh-Gilead, they kill everybody, and they found 400 unmarried virgins. And they take the 400 unmarried virgins as captive, and they take them up to Benjamin, the men of Benjamin, and they said, here's 400 women, now you can start raising families again. But that left 200 Benjamites that didn't have wives, because there were 600 that had fled. So they said, it says in verse 15 of chapter 21, the congregation felt sorry for the people of Benjamin because the Lord had broken the unity of the tribe. You get this? The Lord had broken the unity of the tribe. The Lord didn't have anything to do with this. They did it on their own. They did it because they were making decisions without asking God. So the leaders of the congregation asked, well, now what should we do to provide wives for the men that are left? And some said, Benjamin's men who survived must be allowed to have families. No tribe should be wiped out, which is just a common sense thing. However, we can't give them any wives because we've taken an oath not to. So they come up with a scheme, and it says, well, now there's a festival. Every year, the Lord's festival is held in Shiloh, which is where the ark was being kept. And they go out and in Shiloh, so the girls will go out and they dance during this festival. So they tell the men of Benjamin, you go hide in the vineyards, and when the girls come out dancing, you creep out of the vineyards, grab one, and take them home. I mean, it sounds almost like, you know, cowboys and Indians, doesn't it? if it wasn't so tragic, it could be a comedy, but it's tragic. So during the festival, while the girls were out dancing, the men of Benjamin did just that. They captured the number of wives that they needed, and they rebuilt their cities and lived in them. Verse 24 says, at that time, the people of Israel left each man, went to his tribal family, and they all went home. And then it ends with the same thing that it started with. And in those days, Israel did not have a king, and everyone did whatever he considered right. And the beat goes on. And the beat goes on. We need to understand, and I've had this discussion with other people who feel that if men were just left alone, they would the good side of man would rise to the surface and we would all do the right things. But the Lord says that men's heart are evil and their thoughts are constantly wicked. And we have this nature of sin that has been placed in us because of Adam's sin. Eve was deceived, but Adam made the decision to eat from that tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He hadn't been deceived. He just followed what his wife, put before him.
And sin came into our lives. We became creatures with a nature of sin in us. And left on our own, we will destroy ourselves. All you have to do is look around at every nation, every tribe, every kingdom that has ever been on this earth, and you will find that that's exactly what men do. And the only way to get away from that is to seek the Lord while he may be found. The only way to get away from that is to turn our hearts and our lives over to Jesus Christ, who comes in and gives us a new heart. The Bible says God will put into us a heart of flesh, take away the heart of stone. He makes us into a new creation. We become new creatures in Christ. Old things, the old things of life are passed away. Behold, all things become new. Now, the old nature doesn't go away at this particular time. But what does happen is the Holy Spirit comes into our lives. And he is there then kind of as a police officer, a keeping track of us and warning us about dangers and showing us the right thing to do and convicting us when we fall short and we sin. The Holy Spirit is there to give to us wisdom and understanding, to open our eyes to the things of God and help us to see what God is doing and what God has done in our lives. And if we're willing to listen to the Holy Spirit that God has placed in each one of us, we can live lives that are pleasing in the eyes of God. We have to learn how to keep the law that God gave. And you say, well, I'm free from the law. No, we're free from the guilt of the law. We're free from the punishment of the law. But the law remains, as Jesus has said, the law will not disappear. He says, I didn't come to destroy the law. I came to fulfill it. I came to pay the penalty for those who break it. But the thing is, the law is still what God wills for us to live by. It's his will for humanity. And when we have that Holy Spirit within us and we're listening to what the Holy Spirit says, we will do the things that please God. It is only when we choose to ignore what the Holy Spirit is saying and choose to do what we feel is the right thing to do, and we choose to be, you know, obedient to our own hearts, not to the Spirit of God, that we start to falter and fail. And remember, all these bad decisions lead to tragedy. We look at our own nation. A lot of bad decisions have been made in this country since World War II. Probably some before that, but you know, I wasn't around before that, so I can't say. But since World War II, a lot of bad decisions have been made in this nation. And with each bad decision, we have pushed the will of God a little bit farther aside. We've made him a little bit less of the God over our nation and more an advisor. Until nowadays, we don't even seek him for advice. We look at him as someone who is intruding. And every time that we do those kind of things, we see our society start to crumble. We see things happening to the family that are just ridiculous. We have a problem with families nowadays. We have a problem with people who, you know, are just living for pleasure and living for fun and not caring about anyone else and not caring about the results, not caring about those lives that may be affected, whether it's an abortion or families or whatever it might be, not caring about anyone except self. And now we can't even get along with ourselves, just like the Israelites. We're fighting one another, you know, fighting tribe against tribe because they couldn't get along with themselves because they had pushed the will of God, the law of God, out and chose to live by sentiment and live by what the world around them was doing. And it was tragic. But praise God. Praise God, he always had a judge. And later on we see that he brought in the prophets and the priests, Nathan and Samuel. And then he had the prophets who were there to advise the kings. God is always there influencing the people, drawing them back. And every time that they rebelled against him, he would have to teach them a lesson. And then when they turned back to him, he would open his arms and draw them back in again. And my belief is this, that God is just waiting for us to turn back to him. And he's willing to open his arms and draw America back into himself. He's willing to take take the what is left of our civilization here and revitalize it through the power of the Holy Spirit. If we treat the blood of Jesus Christ as though it's sacred and that it is our only hope for salvation. He wants us to be His children. He loves you. He loves me. Certainly He's going to let us suffer the consequences of our stupidity. But when we're willing to turn back to Him, He is willing with open arms to receive us unto Himself. And so the lesson we need to learn here today isn't so much about all the bad decisions that Israel made. The lesson we need to learn here today is that we have made bad decisions ourselves, but God is waiting for us to return to Him, to seek Him, to seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and He'll take care of everything else. God is waiting for us to trust in the Lord with all of our hearts and not lean on our own understanding, but to acknowledge Him in everything. That means make sure that He is in the center of everything that we do, and then He will make the path straight before us. God's plan for you and for me, for America, for every person on the face of this earth, God's plan is that none of us should perish, but that we should all come to repentance through Christ. That's God's plan. So it's time for us to sit back and evaluate our own lives. It's time for us to say, am I serving God or am I serving self? And if I can't say that what I am doing with my life right now is what God has told me that I should be doing with my life right now, I'm serving myself. So let's be honest with ourselves and honest with God. And let's turn to Him. And let's repent of our sin. And let's seek His face. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we come because we have no right to come in any other way. We come, O Father, only because Christ has paid the price for our sins. We come, O Lord God, because we are in need. We are in need of forgiveness. We are in need of a Savior. We are in need of guidance. We are in need of wisdom. We are in need of understanding. Lord God, we come before You because we need You. There's nothing in this world, O God, that we need more than You. And so, Lord, we've done a great job of messing things up. We've made a lot of bad decisions, and we're suffering because of it. And so, Lord, today we just ask now that You would touch our lives, touch our hearts, touch our minds. Help us, O God, to take a good look, not at our neighbor, but at ourselves. And say, Lord, forgive me for the bad decisions that I've made. Forgive me, Lord God, for not seeking Your face, seeking Your will. Forgive me, Father, for being such a foolish person as to think that I knew how to handle my life. Because, Lord, I can't even get up in the morning without Your help. Show me the way, Lord God. Open our hearts and teach us Your will. Teach us Your ways. So that we can glorify You, praise Your name, and give You all the honor that is due to You. We ask in Jesus. Amen. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. Thank You for Your Holy Spirit, which comes and abides in us and strengthens us, leads us and guides us and convicts us. Thank You, Father. And now may each one be blessed by God and be uplifted by the Holy Spirit. May joy and peace and love fill their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless each one. Thank you for joining us. Bye.